maybe we'll start with you. I'd like to ask, what's next for you?
Not sure. I think this is a real opportunity for a bit of a break, time for reflection. And I'm not done yet in terms of following a new passion. So I'll be seeking that out, and hopefully in the new year, more to be said on that. I don't have anything firm at this stage, but healthcare is my passion. Education, I spent time there, and government services writ large. So I'm hopeful that in the public service, in the human service sector, there may be opportunities.
Can we say healthcare at this point?
Can we say
if you'll be continuing in healthcare?
Hope to. But I think I'm open to a broad range of possibilities. And the reason I say that is better to be employed.
And you wrote a little bit about it, about why you didn't want to have a part in the new health authority. Can you tell us a little bit about why not?
Oh, for sure. And I think this is a really important time in any transition and transformation. It's going to take a lot of energy in terms of reorganization, making sure reporting lines are clear, bringing together financial systems, statistical and IT systems. We've got a lot of technical areas that need to be worked on. It could be bylaws, it could be policies, and that in and of itself, I've done it before. I did lead 32 districts, amalgamating into 12 regional health authorities. I just felt better for someone else to take that turn, and I'll stick to my passion, which is, how do we improve care? What does the future look like? What's the vision for areas like long-term care, palliative care, the new evolution of acute care? Where are things going, and how can I, in some way, play a part in making those improvements?
Do you think the amalgamation is the right move for healthcare in Saskatchewan?
I think it was the only move. You know, as we took a look at it, the mantra was think and act as one. And we've been saying that for several years. I think now is the time to be one. So what works is when you think about the opportunity, the benefit of scale and scope of a larger organization, and figure out a way to balance that with avoiding bureaucracy, allowing decisions around care to be at the point of care, allowing teams to move with great flexibility, and establish yourself so we don't stifle innovation. That is a working formula.
Now, whether it's the right decision or not, like, there's obviously going to be some hiccups as we make this transition. What do you think is going to be the most difficult thing in the next few weeks as we go through this?
So you're looking at a situation where every single senior leader has a new job. Some, in terms of the vice presidents who we currently have, will have new titles. There will be a bit of stability, but the senior leadership team, the entire team, they have new jobs. So the learning curve is going to be very steep. They may have had responsibility in a particular geographic area, for a particular range of services, and now their work will expand quite broadly. So relationships, roles, getting to know people and understanding, having walked the floor, walked the street, know exactly what it is that's being delivered, and then identifying what the plan forward is. That's going to be the challenge. And if it were me, not that I should be giving advice, I think I mentioned in that story that, it's hard not to give armchair advice. But if it were me, I'd be focused on the people.
And obviously a huge learning curve for senior leadership. What should frontline staff be prepared for in the coming weeks?
I don't think there's going to be any disruption. The disruptions will be very minimal. They may see new logos, new forms, new communiques. They'll have an interaction with a new team with some different players. But the beauty of this approach is that it really is intended to minimize the impact for frontline providers. Now, in the longer term, the improvements that this is, I mean, the fundamental basis for this is to make sure that there's smooth transitions for patients, that matters not what health region you belong to, that your care is provided in the right place at the right time and by the right provider.
Was enough time given for a smooth transition?
I think we could have, I don't believe we could have taken any more time. These things come to a time when people are prepared, and I think we're at a stage right now where many are saying, let's get on with it. We're ready. And that readiness is really about an appetite to be part of something. So thus far we've been focused on transition. What we really want to get into is transformation. I say we in the broadest sense. Obviously it's we without me.
How are you feeling on your second last day and last meeting ever in this capacity? I imagine you'll still be going to meetings.
it was tough. I wanted to put on a good face for the board, so you didn't see too many tears. Mike doesn't appreciate when I break down like that. partly it's mixed feelings, right? Part of me says, gee, I'm really going to miss this. It's been 30 years of providing service to the health sector, except for 2 years in education, 30 years. And that transition's going to be tough. I don't know what comes next. So a little bit of trepidation. But you know what? In reflecting, it's been just such a privilege. And to be privileged to have served in these capacities, I've had the best jobs anyone could wish for in Saskatchewan. That privilege is not lost on me. So I'm thankful to have had that privilege. And I look forward to contributing in new ways.
You talked about some of the initiatives that started here, and you're optimistic that they'll be continuing under the new authority. What are some of the big ones to you that you really want to see that still take shape and continue?
Yeah, so my chairperson has much more insight in terms of setting a strategic direction for the board. But when I reflect on the board's direction, on Mr. Stansrud's direction, I think about the connected care strategy, about providing teams within acute care that are really dedicated to patients, rather than have patients move about in hospital. So that work that's going on at St. Paul's Hospital and is spreading. I think about the potential of what we refer to as cellular design, which is really about teamwork, where we take centralized services and we decentralize them, so that you have functions, whether it be the person that's building the budget, allocating the dollars, scheduling, or assisting with human resource and labor relations issues, to put them closer to the ground, to be able to work amongst a team. When it comes to quality and safety, if we can move even further with our cellular design, that teamwork will allow those units to reach their full potential. So when we measured it, we found it quite interesting that managers on units were spending 3% of their time with their staff. And before anyone says, well, you know, let's be critical of that, it's no different across Canada. With that type of percentage, it's unbelievable how we can expect that they'll look after the health, the safety, the quality, that they'll look after budgets and payroll, all of those responsibilities. So I'm pleased to say that where we're moving is for managers to be the clinical specialists that they are, to provide the presence and problem solving that's needed on the unit level. And they've moved up now and moving even to greater numbers. A quarter of their time is spent on the floor. We would obviously love 75-80%, and that's the vision. So that's one area. If I go through the rest, it may take some time. Mike, why don't you talk about the new door?
Well, we're really excited that some new doors are going to open up. So, in the community, it won't be very long before, in our vision, that those new doors open up in multiple locations around the community. It's so critical for the health system to recognize what we do very well and what we don't do very well. What we do so wonderfully well is save your life. We're very good at that in our emergency departments. But our emergency departments were not designed and cannot continue to be the catch-all, do-all for everyone, for everything within the system. So I have great faith that the new Saskatchewan Health Region and its CEO will take forward that most important connecting into the community design that we've helped pioneer here in the Saskatoon Health Region. That will allow new doors for care into the system rather than the singular door that we have now, which is overwhelmed and doesn't and is not appropriate for so many people. So with that starting, and I have great faith based on conversations that I've had with both the new CEO and the new board chair, Mr. Dick Carter, that that initiative amongst the other six or seven initiatives that Dan has spoken about today are absolutely front and center on their agenda. And if that's the case, then we leave both proud of the efforts that have been put forward by the board and by the senior leadership team here, and confident for the future that these changes, these transformational changes, will occur.
By doors, what do you mean exactly?
You'll be able to go to another door if you require some care that is specifically designed for the demographic of the neighborhood that you live in. It won't be, I imagine, it won't be very long before more and more care will be delivered in your own home, both by public health nursing and by physicians as well.
Is it an emotional time for you, this being the last meeting?
Emotional. I'm not sure it's emotional. It's just a path that has come to an end. The most important thing that has happened in my tenure here is the lifelong friendships that I've been able to make with people, both external, with board members, and internal, with senior management. The management and the commitment by the senior leadership team here is unbelievable. They really care. I'll never forget being down in emergency with my mom when she had broken her hip. And we had a power outage, and it was a serious issue. And one of our directors was running down the hall with battery-operated suction devices. I mean, when you see your senior leaders running down the hall with delivering equipment, you know you have the right people. So it's sad in a sense that some of those friendships, some of those respectful interactions that you have in life come to an end, because you know they're going to be so much less frequent. At the same time, it's time for a new group to come through with some new thoughts. But we're proud of the fact that the new group is embracing so many of the critical paths that we had put forward and we're working on with the ministry, with government, and now with the new board, that they're going to grab hold of those challenges and run forward with them. And I believe that they'll have great success.
What's next for you?
Well, I'm a volunteer here. I've always acted as a volunteer. I've never taken a penny for my time here. So it really doesn't matter if I lose the income. I'm looking forward to spending more time at Cosmo Industries, which has always been a real passion for myself and my family. And it's fun to be involved in those organizations. One of the things about being involved in volunteering in health is sometimes there's just a glacial pace of change. And at Cosmo Industries, if we made a couple of dollars, we can vote, and everyone agrees that let's buy sweaters for everyone. And on Thursdays, the sweaters arrive. So there's just a different pace of change, and so it'll be nice to get back to Cosmo Industries.
So Mike, are you suggesting that we have to form a sweater committee?
Yeah, maybe we should have a sweater committee. That would have fixed it up for me.